Okay, great. A very good afternoon, everyone, as we are celebrating World Women's Day at Entrepreneur. This is our ode to women who have made an inspiration to us all. Nearly two decades ago, technology and women were rarely spoken in the same breath. As a matter of fact, very few thought that women who seemed relegated to doing home chores would make it to the entrepreneur world, especially in technology. And today, our theme at this special session is to highlight the prowess of women who have made it big in technology, and looking at them, I can rightly say the future of fintech is female. With this, let me welcome our panelists for this session: Ms. Priya Sharma, co-founder Zest Money; Ms. Nupur Gupta, co-founder Neera; and Ms. Shruti Agarwal, co-founder Stashfin. Ladies, welcome to this very special session of Entrepreneur, and a virtual hug to all of you.
Thank you.
So to start with, and I'm being joined by my colleague Aditya in this conversation. We would like to understand more from each one of you on what inspired you all to start this journey, because in banking in particular, we've all seen a lot of women have made their mark, and now in fintech, we are seeing the same trend coming. A lot of women founders keep coming in this segment and are making it big, and all three of you are example of that. So if all of you could share your journey on how you got into the fintech space and being the founder, how has been the journey for each one of you? Priya, would you like to go
Sure.
first?
Yeah, sure. So my journey in entrepreneurship and fintech actually started in London in 2011. And before that, I was doing investment banking, so I was in financial services. And I had a technology background before that. So when I was in banking, I started looking at some of the technology companies that were being built at the time. This was very much at the sort of Web 2.0 stage, where apps were coming into prominence. Smartphones were coming into prominence, especially in the Western world. And definitely there was a movement towards disruption of various different segments using technology, and very quickly realized that financial services or fintech is going to be the next wave. And so I joined a fintech company called Wonga in the UK, and very much was inspired by their vision of disrupting financial services using technology, and kind of learned my ropes there. I became the India team along with my other co-founders, who we later on spun off and we started Zest. But that's where we learned the ropes. We saw how the new wave of technology was transforming businesses, transforming financial services, how we could build completely new and innovative business models using technology and AI. And so that was really kind of our learning ground. And then in 2015, we saw that the Indian ecosystem had evolved quite significantly. Payments had started leapfrogging, and there were new things that were happening in payments, the likes of Paytm and some of these companies that have now become household names were getting created. And that's when we felt that this was the right time for us to start a fintech company in India. And within that, we obviously had spent a lot of time trying to understand what's happening in financial services in India. We are a digital consumer lending product, which is now most commonly known in the world as a buy now pay later product. So we launched with that. We were the first, and we are now the largest buy now pay later product in India. And we really saw the opportunity for this product as we realized that consumers are becoming increasingly aspirational, and obviously people are on their mobile, they're transacting. So a lot of these themes started coming together for us, and we felt that 2015 or early 2016 was the right time, and that's when we took the plunge.
Sure, interesting. So we'll come back to you on more. So Nupur, if you could also share about your startup journey.
Sure. So for me, the first point of entry in finance was basically my first job, and the motivation at that time was very simply and naively to see how one can use maths to make money after having originally come from engineering technology sort of background. Now, after having done that for a few years across the stack, originating, pricing, credit risk analysis, After a while, I felt a certain lack of purpose and meaning in the work that I was doing. At the same time, I also caught winds of these secular trends in the financial industry, driven by technology and the timing of various different things being brought together at the same time. When I saw that the impact of these new age financial services resulting from the combination of ease of distribution through technological channels, ease of data availability, and multiple other factors like that, positive outlook from the regulators. When I thought that the impact that an opportunity that a product like digital financial service, in particular credit, can have on an economy like India is far greater than any other country you can pick out in the world. So the fintechs solves the problem on the fringe in countries like UK and US, which are already very well developed with respect to credit and financial services over the decades. But in India, it can solve the problem starting from the access, and then the second order problems such as efficiency and quality. So that was the motivation for me to then jump ship and start Neera. At Neera, we are focusing on the problem of need as opposed to wants. We have people across, we have the vast population today in India, which is underserved with respect to credits and have to resort to very informal channels, which don't help them over the long term. We are now able to systemize that by better utilizing the data available about these individuals to start giving them small loans, bring them into the formal system, and then bill on top of that.
Okay, sure. So Shruti, you started, you were working at Bank of America previously, if I'm correct, and then you started Stashfins. So what was the inspiration behind it?
Yeah, absolutely. So my experience a bit more personal than Nupur's and Priya's. So, you know, when we moved back from the US, I applied for an American Express card and I got rejected. I got rejected twice. And the pedigree I come from is, you know, being a chartered accountant, worked with top tier companies in the US and gone to an Ivy League college. It was quite surprising that I got rejected. And I wondered, you know, people who haven't got the exposure, what happens to folks like that? And, you know, I had love for retail marketing with my previous experience with Secret Cache in the US in 2009. And then when we moved back, you know, Tushar Agarwal was starting, couple of years later, Stashfin. The love of finance and retail came together in the form of fintech, Stashfin. And it was a perfect opportunity to get people who are underserved, underbanked, making them financially responsible and providing them an aspirational product when you're just not providing them unsecured loan, but providing a footprint to them where they can then go on and take auto loans and personal loans, and in fact, even take home loans and grow with the company. And that's been the whole aspect or the thought process behind Stashfin, doing financial inclusion, getting folks who are not having a credit footprint back into the space and making Stashfin an aspirational product through its credit line of card.
Sure. So I want to understand from all of you, from the time you had started to now, when we see the recent event of trends like COVID, and now when we're talking about the new normal, how the market has evolved, and for each of you in particular, I mean, how do you see your journey evolving further with the market shaping up now?
I mean, I can probably, I definitely feel COVID has been a watershed event for us, especially with our product, which is, as I mentioned earlier, a buy now, pay later product. And it's a completely digital, you know, credit product that is designed for enabling purchases or commerce, either online or offline. And definitely in the COVID times, what we have realized is that consumers are looking for completely, firstly, cashless, but also contactless payment solutions. And, you know, we have all, I guess, used UPI a lot more in the last year than we probably ever did. Definitely UPI transactions are, you know, through the roof and month on month, right? So, so we feel that that basically is signaling a significant consumer shift towards mobile-based digital payments. And it also signals a complete shift away from, you know, definitely away from cash, but also away from card. And for us, we are a mobile-based credit, you know, application. And we are basically embedded into wherever the customer is making a transaction. And instead of paying through their bank account or through UPI, they can actually use us to, you know, to use credit, and especially more, it makes more sense to pay with credit if you are buying a relatively slightly larger ticket size and things like that, right? So for us, it's the significant shift in consumer behavior from any sort of card or cash to mobile is what we are seeing. And definitely what we are seeing is a completely contactless solution that is now being preferred by consumers. And we are very much in that space of providing credit at the point of a transaction. And that has led to, you know, a lot of, you know, growth in our business. And we definitely see that in that momentum kind of continuing going forward, because that's a, as I said, it's a consumer behavior shift. This is something that has also happened in the rest of the world. So it's not just an India phenomenon, where consumers are increasingly moving in terms of their transaction base or in terms of their purchase behavior. They're moving online. E-commerce, obviously, as we all know, has grown significantly in the COVID period. And therefore, any sort of payment option or credit option that is enabling any e-commerce or online retail or omni-channel retail, as I said, contactless is a key part of that process, even on the offline world. So it's not just what's happening on the online, it's also what's happening in the offline. And that's a key consumer shift. And we feel that we are in this perfect storm, and all the work that we have been doing over the last 4 years in terms of building this product, building this category, creating consumer awareness around buy now, pay later, is just, you know, we're now on this massive growth path going forward.
Sure. So when we saw the economy taking a nosedive, I mean, last year, and particularly in the first half of 2020, I mean, when we saw a lot of, layoffs happening and people were not sure about their regular income, how do, at your level, make sure that, okay, the credit which you are giving right now is going to come back? How do you assess that, or that has changed over a period of time?
Yeah, definitely made changes to our, oh, sorry, is that for other people or should I go ahead?
No, please continue, and others can also participate.
Sorry. Yeah, so definitely we've made shifts to our credit platform, and that's something that we, do all the time. But yes, we are very cognizant of making sure that everything that we do is affordable and everything that we do is relatively, it makes sense for the customer, and also is not putting people into, you know, unnecessary kind of debt arrangements. So yes, we have made changes during, especially during COVID. We did a lot of work around estimating people's incomes and how that might have changed over time, and whether or not, you know, they might be under some sort of stress, or whether they might be over leveraged at the moment. So all of these factors have definitely gone in, and we see that some of the work that we did in March, April around that is now playing out really well. And that has kind of helped us, grow and sustain growth through this time, basically.
Sure.
Nupur,
Shruti, if you would like to add to it.
Sure, happy to go ahead. So we saw a lot of movement. You know, the funny thing is, in RBI or in Hindi, there's no word for moratorium. That, you know, people think it's a EMI maaf, or you don't have to pay anything at all. So we as a company went ahead, and I think we were the leaders in that. We spent a lot of time educating our customers that moratorium does not mean that EMI is waived off. It just means that you pay interest on interest and you can defer your principal. And a lot of education went in teaching a customer being financially responsible, that, you know, rest of expenses have gone down, where you would be doing fuel expenses, traveling, or, you know, a lot of people we saw, being a transient population that we are, a lot of people move into tier one, tier two cities. They went back to the village. They had excess income because they were not paying rents. We educated them that they should go ahead and pay any excess income, excess cash flow they may have, to pay down their EMIs and not pay, take the moratorium. So we came up with a product where, not a product, but a policy where month on month you can avail moratorium. And if you have excess cash, go ahead and pay it off. So that had a huge impact. We saw customers accepting it very, very well. So towards the end of it, you know, there was so much confusion with how the CIBIL footprint will be reported, how different products will report, you know, how home loan is reporting, how credit cards are reporting. It was very clear for us, and that really helped customers get out of this, you know, not being financially responsible to becoming financially responsible, understanding what the policies were doing for them. And we were able to offer cash or loans to them as and when they needed. So we really became that their support structure towards the end of the moratorium or even today.
Sure.
Nupur? Yeah, so just to add, so if you are an onlooker or a stakeholder in financial, and particularly in credit space, then you always wait for an economic downturn event like COVID to really test the strength of the business. So it's to see that how does a business perform during a stress test like this, that goes to show how strong of a credit business it is. So on that metric, now that the worst of the COVID is behind us, we can say that we have really managed COVID very well. So throughout the worst of the COVID, we never put more than 2% of our loan book under moratorium. We continue to stay in touch with the customer and worked out collection strategies with them. Instead of losing touch with them, continued to collect little that they were comfortable paying. So if, especially in the early days of COVID, the April 20, which was of the worst lockdown month and where the uncertainties were the highest, we noticed that while the overall job loss or pay loss fraction was pretty small as a percentage of the overall portfolio, there was a lot of fear amongst the customers about whether they'll be able to take care of the higher priorities in life, putting food on the table next month, which was kind of driving the non-payment behavior. And we worked with the customers to psychologically got them over the line and then ended up managing COVID quite well. We finished last year five times higher volume versus where we started. We are back to our growth rates that we were at going into COVID. And another change that has happened is, so COVID really sensitized the financial ecosystem. So because finance is such a vital service, it does not operate in its isolation. There is always a ecosystem of partners that you build up on, banks being a key player there, along with all the way from entities like UIDAI and PCI. So the ecosystem at large has been sensitized towards the urgency of digital modes of delivering finance. And that also helps fintechs like us to accelerate the path going forward.
Sure. Well, so, Sheena, like, so, you know, as a, like, you know, a challenge, basically, you know, like, you know, the startups, you know, has a bit of many issues over there. But to understand that, you know, what is the biggest roadblock for the startups in India to thrive? I mean, is it laws, compliance laws, regulatory laws? What exactly, like, is the biggest challenge for the startups across sectors, which, you know, creates a kind of, you know, basically hurdle in the market? So if I can show you on that, please.
Since my line is unmuted, I'll go forward. So as much as finance can be a force for good, it's also a great market opportunity, and it has attracted some bad actors. So particularly early 19, we saw signs of a rush of lending apps on Play Store coming from China, Southeast Asia, which were charging usurious lending rates, really taking customers for a ride. And ultimately unfortunate, resulting in unfortunate events like suicides that were reported, started to get reported around Christmas time last year. It's a bit unfortunate that it took an event like that for those at the helm to take note. But when an event like that happens, it's bad for the industry as a whole, because then everyone kind of gets swept under the same hand. But better to have captured it sooner rather than later. So I suppose, the regulator in the country is one of the best regulators out there, and we expect them to be able to find out a way so that we don't rush, we don't sort of see events like that recurring again. Beyond that, I think the another challenge that I would talk about kind of goes back to the earlier point that I was making about finance industry being heavily dependent on an ecosystem of players.
Yeah.
So now to ensure the delivery of my product to the customer, I have got exposure to UIDAI API qualities. I've got exposure to NPCI technology, and which are not good exposures to take on. And hopefully, I think with the sensitization towards the need for digitization will help us to see those issues or those sort of challenges get resolved sooner than it would take otherwise. Compliance, I would not take too much issue with. Ultimately, credit is a regulated industry for a reason. There is a lot at stake, and there is the most aware sort of customers who could be taken for a ride. So there is a need of a neutral third-party oversight provider. But the belts and the hooks could be set up in such a way that it's reflective of the century that we are in, instead of the one that we left behind.
Sure. Well, I see the internet actually has been an issue in the Indian markets, basically, especially in the small towns. So I want to understand that, what is your take on the exploring the unbanked Indian market, especially in all those tier two, tier four towns, basically. So what's your take on that?
So I can answer that. I think there's a huge market out there. Indian market is underpenetrated. The aspirations still remain in terms of having a home, having a credit card, having the option to buy the vehicle you want. And as the millennials are growing and they're taking a vast portion of our population, the demand will just rise. So tapping that market, it becomes very, very important. And I think we've actively, Stashfin has actively gone and done that. And in fact, the government has done a great job. I think we are in the forefront when it comes to fintech in payments. UPI is world-class. Just stabilizing the policies by the government, making sure there's no ambiguity as we enter these deep markets, which has potential, becomes easier. And I think the sky is going to be the limit, and India is going to be no less than any developed country when it comes to a credit footprint.
Sure. Well, also, I just want to understand that. See, mostly the Indians, they deal with the cash, actually. And being in a digital, medium, how would you, gain a trust, on those people, in the small towns, because they hardly use, apps or the phones, basically. So how do you just explore that market in such a way to educate them rather about this advantage of fintech apps and to transact through, all those Paytms and Google Pay. So how would you convince them in such a way?
I'm happy to take that answer. So, I agree, with COVID, I think the eyes have opened. The telcos have going aggressively upgrading the 3Gs to 4Gs and then going into the 5Gs. The penetration is going to be immense. The ones who are not penetrated, who are not using smartphones or who are not there on the OTTs, I think the network has been made pretty strong by the Vodafones and the Ideas and the Airtels of India, where you can go in and recharge your phone. And the idea is to penetrate through those platforms and get a credit imprint through those. So that's the strategy Stashfin is taking when it is entering tier two, tier three, and tier, the rural areas of India.
Sure. And if I may ask, you know, about the growth prospects of the fintech startups across the Indian market, maybe down the 5-6 years, how would you see the market?
I mean, we see a lot of growth opportunities across fintech. I think if you look at the overall fintech landscape, it's a huge landscape, right? So it's obviously payments, which are definitely always at the forefront, and there has been a lot of work that has happened over the last 5-6 years or even more on that. And definitely India is now seen as the leader in payments globally. Like our UPI networks are something that, you know, no one in the world has, and definitely NPCI and some of these other agencies are actually actively consulting, you know, central banks and banking networks across the world. So definitely on payments, we have made huge strides. On lending, you know, I think most of the consumer lending and SME lending startups started in India around 2013, 2014 onwards. And even in lending, again, we have seen a lot of, you know, growth and movement. I think that as, you know, payments is kind of the first wave, lending has been the sort of second wave. Payments is already in terms of the number of players, it's become highly concentrated and I would say, you know, consolidated. But at the same time, the technology has been evolving very rapidly. And even the large players are always, you know, they have to be on the top of their game. Otherwise, you know, in 6 months, someone else could come up and take the market share. So it is hugely competitive. I think with the digital lending also, I think we're definitely in that phase, and definitely from lending has been, or in general, it becomes tough during economic downturn. So we will definitely see a sort of a shakeup, some of which has already happened or is happening. And we will see a little bit of a consolidation, or we will see some of the larger players becoming larger. And therefore, that would also benefit in terms of growing the, you know, lending landscape. In terms of other verticals like insurance, wealth management. So insurance, obviously, I think the good news is that FDI has been opened up for some time now. So some of those things are very welcome news. And I think definitely there would be more competition, more innovation as a result of that. Even in the wealth space, in the last few years, we have seen a lot of startups, and a lot of those startups are now increasingly gaining traction, and there's a huge consumer adoption. Definitely in COVID times, we have seen, you know, Zerodha emerge as one of the big, you know, fintech winners. And this is obviously an amazing story where it's almost one of its kind, and as a product and as a platform. And they have really grown stupendously during the last, you know, couple of years, right? So definitely a lot of these amazing stories are now beginning to come up. We are now operating at a global scale. And global players are taking note of what is happening in India, in the entire fintech, you know, universe. We will soon see some of these Indian fintech players start to expand globally as well. We will see some sort of, you know, maybe Southeast Asian or some other neighboring countries expansion as well. So we really are building for the future. You know, there's a lot of innovation that is happening in the ecosystem, and definitely I see that a lot of the, you know, fintech players are very ambitious and are very innovative, and that will ultimately drive the overall ecosystem and the industry forward. So I would say the future is bright, and definitely we will see some very good companies and very, very good products that are being built already and will be successful at not just the Indian level, but also the global level.
Sure, brilliant. Yeah. And see, you know, I believe like any startup, you know, if they have to thrive in the market, you know, there has to be some ease, you know, in the governmental policies. So when, you know, it comes to, like, you know, the fintech startup, so what's your take on the policies, you know, by the government?
So in general, I mean, the policy framework is, you know, from a startup perspective, it's pretty conducive. There are usually some confusion that sort of crops up from time to time, but in general, as startups, I would say that it is a conducive environment, especially when it comes to fintech. Having a very good regulator, very stable regulatory environment provided by the RBI and, you know, SEBI and some of these other regulators is also seen as a positive. So I would say overall policy is positive. Yes, we do have certain, you know, changes that keep getting announced sometime, but that's true anywhere in the world. And in general, I would say it is a favorable environment overall.
Sure.
So since all of you spoke about how financing is helping Bharat and in particular India in the current time, so we also wanted to understand from each one of you, how has been the funding scenario for all of you when you went out seeking funds from investors? I would like to understand, I mean, as an entrepreneur, does it make any difference when a woman is seeking funds as compared to a male counterpart?
Yeah, I can answer that. You know, just before the lockdown, we finished our equity round of funding. And since then, you know, the markets were shrinking, but we've seen surge of demand, you know, lenders coming to us. And even though we had shut down dispersals, lenders wanting to lend to us for further lending to customers. So I don't think it's anything about a woman or a man. It's more about the business and how it's performing. How Neera said, how Nupur said that if it's growing, you know, there's no end to it, whether it's a man or a woman. It's just the strength of the business. And we feel that during the strength of this business, Stashfin, we've seen a surge of lenders coming our way and wanting to partner with us.
Sure. That's great to know. Priya, Nupur, any instances you would like to share with us?
I mean, look, I think in terms of funding rounds, in general, we have to focus on what the opportunity is, what we're trying to build as a company, what the product is doing, how we're tracking to the metrics. So I think it's more about what you're building and how much conviction you have and how much proof points you're able to show in it rather than any sort of gender bias. It's obviously very difficult to do this kind of A/B test to say that if there is an exactly same product and exactly same business model, and then if there were, in our case, we are two women co-founders and one more, so we're three co-founders. So it's very difficult to do this kind of A/B testing and say that, okay, if there were three men in a room and versus like two women and a man, like how would that conversation go? So ultimately you don't think about these things. You just focus on what you know and as an entrepreneur. And what we know is that there is this huge opportunity out there, that we have a product that makes sense, that there is a huge value proposition and product market fit. And then so after a point, then it is about, once you've got that initial product market fit, it is just about growing and it's about improving and executing on your plans and strategies. So I think that's what ultimately investors look at. And it's obviously, you know, there are gender biases, but it's very difficult to say whether or not it has impacted us or not, or how would have things turned out or would things have been different for us had things been different.
Sure. Nupur, do you have anything else, anything different, any other opinion to share with us?
Sure. I mean, I think as an entrepreneur, when you're worrying about the problems that you will be solving, being a woman trying to raise money is not the most important. The most important problem, as Priya hinted at as well, is finding your product market fit and the journey to finding that product market fit. That's the biggest challenge that you will face as an entrepreneur. And once you do that, then rest of it becomes easy. Then you will raise your funds, then you'll keep on growing your customers and have them pay you for it. Because we are all credit businesses out here, so there are two forms of funding that we run on. There's the debt funding and the equity funding. So in the wake of a crisis like COVID or post a crisis like COVID, what happens is a flight to safety. And that's what we have seen reflected very clearly in debt investors. So there's a lot of demand, or rather a lot of supply of debt towards the towards the lenders, be it fintech or otherwise, who have performed well during the COVID. They have more and more debt available to them to because money needs deploying. And then lastly, on the equity front, I think, so we were in a good position going into COVID as well, because we had just raised a round getting in. And then the mid of the COVID, after having demonstrated good collection performance, and after also seeing the shakeup that was happening in the lending industry in the wake up in the wake of COVID, it became very clear that now more than ever before, we have the opportunity, we have the ground cleaner and greener in front of us to take the lead and shoot for the market leadership opportunity. So we went on to do another top-up fundraise middle of the year and attracted strong interest from our investors. And coming back out of COVID strong, now the market looks on you as with a lot of positive bias given the fact that the company has survived COVID and come out of it well and growing, which helps the survivors.
Sure. I would just also like to add here that we were looking at the recently published data by one of the investor firms talking about the 44 unicorns which have come up in India. And unfortunately, there's only one woman founder who has built the unicorn startup. I mean, of course, all of you know it's Nykaa, Falguni, and so it's more of a boys club which we see at the unicorn level. So, Ruti, do you think there is much more to do at our level or maybe the entrepreneurial ecosystem to understand more on where women can lead further in the coming time so that we have more unicorn founders in India?
I mean, I'd say we should celebrate the fact that we have someone like Falguni leading the charge, and, you know, Nykaa is such an amazing business and they're doing so well. And really created a new category and are the kind of category winner. So, so while, you know, it's one in 44 at the moment, I think that's having one role model or having at least one person out there is good inspiration for the rest of us. So definitely, I'm sure all of us aspire to be in that club. But also, I think we need to, yeah, so therefore we should look at the positives. We should look at it in a positive light that, look, you know, 10 years ago or 20 years ago, would we have imagined that this would happen? And so this is progress. It's slow progress, but it is progress. And we already have, you know, three founders who are women on this panel. And there are actually a lot of women, you know, fintech founders already. So yes, we are still in a minority, but that's also, if you look at how in general women are, especially in the workplace in India, we have less than, I don't know, 10% women in the workplace formally in India. And so a lot of those changes have to also start coming through, right? And then you will soon see that there will be more women-founded businesses. There will be women businesses founded more towards women's issues or more generic issues. So all of those things will start coming up. I don't think that this is something that we should feel bad about. It's something that, yes, is a work in progress. And we should actually be happy that more and more women are now taking the entrepreneurial plunge, and we should, as an ecosystem, support them and ensure that they grow and, you know, there are more and more role models being created for people to look up to.
I'll just add to that. So when I was working for an investment bank in the US, my role model was my managing director there. And I want to be the same role model for my colleagues here at Stashfin. So we actively focus on women hiring. We are already at 40-60 ratio with 40% women and 60% men. And soon we want to be at the 50-50 ratios. We just find it a little challenging when it comes to STEM to have equal ratios. But I think the company is actively going on to campus, hiring folks earlier on and developing them to be in the fintech space, to follow their dreams and not get bogged down with the cliche role women have in their careers or in the lives of being an Indian here.
Sure.
Just Just to add, so on the bright side, I think beyond looking at CEO level positions, I think if we start looking at sort of key employees inside the organizations, I'm sure we would find a lot of strong and impactful women working inside these top 100 or whatever labeling you're using to find these unicorns or large companies. I mean, if we want to make a change, then it has to start all the way from primary school to secondary school to having more people, more women in universities and STEM fields, and then more women in professional world, and then the follow-on effect will start showing. But it's a long-term investment. It's not something that you can flip a switch today. That being said, like you look at Indian banks, all the ladies, so many ladies, people at the top are women instead of men. And even inside the organizations where you don't see a female CEO, when you look at sort of the key positions who are running the companies, look at Tesla, for example, the person who is the CEO is a woman, and they are the sort of people driving the company forward. So there's a lot of inspiration that we can derive by changing our vantage point as well.
So before we conclude, a final question from each one of you. I mean, of course, when we are talking about women in finance, so I mean, what according to you would be your piece of advice to women who want to enter the finance field, or of course, who are looking at setting up an entrepreneurial venture in this space?
I would just say follow your dream. There's no alternative to hard work. If you're working hard and you are driven, there's nothing stopping you. So just follow your dream with all your passion.
I would just say congratulations. It's a great time to be an entrepreneur in fintech space in India today. So let's talk. And other thing I would say is it's a regulated industry, so have patience, and especially for those who see themselves being fintech entrepreneurs in India, just go to the bosses at the partners that you have, be it bank or some strategic partner that you work with. Just go straight to the bosses. If you deal with the people at the bottom, you'll waste a lot of time. As I said, it's an exciting time to be a fintech entrepreneur in India. So kudos.
Sure.
I'd say take risks. And but at the same time, you know, work hard and build your skills, understand what is happening, understand the pulse of the customer, understand trends, understand where even the market is going, where regulation is going, and try and come up with ideas that are relevant not just for today but also for tomorrow. And then yeah, take risks and get your hands dirty.
With this, we would like to conclude it, and thank you for joining us, and wish you a very happy Women's Day in advance, and may we have more such women entrepreneurs in India, and next time when we talk, we have more such unicorn founder stories to be shared with each other.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.